Hello. In this video, I'm going to be talking about static properties and methods in object-oriented programming. I'm going to start with a quick recap of what properties and methods are first, and then we're going to look into more detail about how this new idea of static properties and methods works, in particular with the C# programming language. Let's begin with a recap of what properties and methods actually are. These are the constructs that allow us to implement and represent the state and behavior of a class of objects. There are some other words that we might use instead of properties, such as variables, attributes, but usually we have this distinction between state being part of the model, our object-oriented model, and properties or variables being talking about the code itself. And then we've got behavior, which links with methods. So behavior is the sort of design word that we use when we're talking about the object-oriented model, and methods or functions might be the word we use, or subroutines, when we're writing the code. When we write the code for a class, we define the properties that each object in that class will have. So each of those objects has a different copy of that variable, so they can have different values that distinguish different objects from each other. And in order to access those variables and also access the methods, the behavior of each object, we need to access those through a reference to that object, call that the object reference. So let's have a look at an example. I've got a very simple example here of a student class that I've defined at the top, and I've got my main program underneath. Each student has a name. There's a constructor here for setting up that name based on a parameter, and a simple get function for that name. So I've got a property here defined at the top, and then a method defined called getName. In the main program, I've instantiated two student objects, and I'm using the getName function here to access the name of the student, which is otherwise private. So when I run this program, I'm going to get me, Matt, in this case. Let's think of an example where we might want to use what's called a static property. So let's explain what that means first. This is when we have a situation where we want to store information that relates to the whole class and that isn't necessarily needing to be different for each individual object. When we have a situation like this, we're going to want to store the information in what's called a static property. And this is like just like an ordinary property, but we've modified it in the code using the static keyword. And obviously it's going to work differently. So let's have a look at an example of that in our student example. So let's say that we want to add, we want to extend this program so that each student has its own unique ID, but we want to make sure that that ID is different for each student object. So firstly, we'd want to make the variable for the ID itself as a non-static property, but then we're going to be able to use a static property here to keep track between different students of what the next ID will need to be. And so as we can see here, it's very similar to an ordinary member variable, except I'm going to add the static keyword before the data type, next ID. Then in the constructor, I will be able to, for each time a new student object is instantiated, that's when the constructor is called, set up its ID using whatever the current value is of that next ID static property. And then I want to increment the next ID so that when we next instantiate a student, it's going to use the next number up in the sequence. The thing that distinguishes the static property here from the non-static property is that this next ID variable is shared between all instances of the student class. So each time next ID is referenced in the student class, it's talking about the same variable, regardless of which student object we're using. In order to show how this is working, I'm going to want to add another method down here. I'm going to create a method called getUsername, and it should return a string, which is, let's say, the name of the student followed by their ID. You might like to have a go at pausing the video and implementing that method now. Okay, there we go. There's my simple implementation of getUsername. When I run this now, hopefully you can see we've got student usernames Matt0 and Kevin2. That shows that the ID here that we're using in getUsername is incrementing each time we're calling that constructor. This is evidencing that the static property next ID is shared between the objects of the student class. Now let's have a think about static methods. Now, these are quite similar to static properties, except instead we're now obviously talking about behavior. So when we've got some behavior that we don't want to be specific to a particular object, that won't necessarily affect the object's non-static properties and state, then we might want to use a static method. So behavior that is shared between all the objects of a class. Again, we're going to use the static modifier in C#. And we're going to see something interesting, which is that the static methods are going to be accessed through the class name, not a reference to the object. Let's have a look at an example of that now with our student example. So let's say we want to extend this slightly further such that each academic year we want to reset the IDs back to zero. So we need to add a method in here for resetting the IDs. It's a static method because it's got the static keyword here. And let's have a look at how we would call that in the main program. Now, we'll notice that if we try to use one of our references to a student object, we're not going to have an option for reset ID. It's not going to be possible there. And that's because with static methods, we need to use the class name itself to call that method. This makes sense because the static method is shared, the behavior is shared between all the objects. And here we can see student.resetID. So instead of one of the references, we use the class name itself in order to call the method. This would be the same if we made the static property public. We would be able to do the same. We'd still need to use the class name to access it. You might think this looks a bit familiar. Actually, it looks very similar to console.writeLine, and that is because writeLine is a static method. In fact, there are quite a lot of static methods in the console class. If I hold control and left click on the console word there, I can take a look into behind the scenes of how console is implemented. Now, most of this stuff is quite confusing, but you'll see that we've got lots of methods to find my console, and they are all static. If we scroll enough, we can eventually find console write line. There we go. And it is a static method. We're going to look at a different example now. In this example, I'm going to be thinking about a vector class, a very simple class that can store two components. In this case, I've called them X and Y. So far, the vector is very, very simple. Now, we're going to be able to use static methods here to make something that's a bit like a library, and this is how some programmers might like to use static methods. So firstly, I'm going to want for my vector a method that will be able to calculate the magnitude of that vector, but we're not going to make it calculate the magnitude of the vector of the object that we're in at the moment. Instead, we're going to allow it to calculate the magnitude of any vector that's passed in as parameter. Let me show you what I mean. This method is going to return the magnitude of that vector v. In fact, you might like to pause the video here and have a go at implementing that function yourself. Okay, there we go. There's my implementation. So we're making sure that we're accessing only the state within the vector v that we've passed in. We're not actually going to be updating x and y here, which is a non-static method that would be specific to a particular object of this type. Now let's have a look at how that would be used in the main program. So I've got two vectors set up here. I want to find the magnitude of A. I'm going to print that out to the console. Instead of doing something like A.magnitude, which would be a different way of implementing this sort of behavior, I'm going to use my static method, which needs to be accessed through the class name, so vector2d, dot get magnitude. I'm going to pass in the reference to my vector object A. This is then going to calculate the magnitude of that vector and print it to the console. So we're also going to create a static method in this little vector library that can add together two vectors. So similar to the other one, instead of accessing any state in a non-static state for a particular object, we're only going to be passing in vector objects as parameters and using the state for those. It's going to be two parameters this time though, right? Because it's adding two vectors together. I'm going to make it return a new vector2d object rather than modifying the state of one of the parameters and returning that, because it might be in the calling code that we want that vector to stay as it is without it being changed. Okay, let's see this one in action then. I can combine some of these together actually, so I can do vector2d add a and b. This is going to first add together vectors a and b and then get the magnitude of the result. So this is just how some programmers quite like to implement libraries, and just a quick example with the vectors there. Okay, so to summarize, let's think about the differences between static and non-static properties and methods. The first is about when properties are initialized. With our ordinary or non-static properties, these are initialized when the object is instantiated, so around the time when that constructor is called. Whereas with static properties, these are initialized once at the start of the program. So remember, we've got one for each variable. We define a static in the class. We've just got one variable there that's created that is shared between all instances of the class. Whereas with non-static properties, we have a new copy of that variable created each time an object is instantiated. The second difference is the way in which we might access static properties and methods. And in the examples I've shown you were with methods only. With ordinary methods, these are accessed through the reference to the object. Whereas with static methods, we use the class name followed by dot, then the method name in order to access that shared behavior. Okay, I hope you found this video useful about static properties and methods. Thank you very much.